five different states
Wow.
before I finished high school. And I don't come from a military family. Just my mom, my brother.
Landed. Okay. So let me just read real quickly through this halftime review. That'll remind us of what we've learned so far in this chapter. Grape uses different case endings to indicate the case. And so far, we've only studied nominative and accusative, with gender, masculine, feminine, or neuter, and number, singular and plural. The stem of the word is the basic form of the word that carries its meaning. It is discovered by removing the case ending. As an example, the word logos, what is the case end, the case ending?
Logos.
Not the, not us, sigma. Just the sigma. The omicron is the last letter of the stem, and it in the case of the words we've learned so far, it's always a vowel, so that's called the stem vowel, but it's part of the stem. The true ending is just the sigma. He's going to make a point of that in just a little bit. Stems ending in alpha or eta are in the first declension. Stems ending in omicron are in the second declension. If a word is a subject of a verb, it is in the nominative case and uses nominative case endings. If a word is the direct object of a verb, it is in the accusative case and uses accusative case endings. Next chapter, chapter 7, we'll learn two more cases. Word order does not determine the function of a word. It has other uses besides that. And I think we talked about in the exegetical insight that he gave us, if a word is thrown to the front of a sentence, it does so for emphasis. Normal Greek order is verb, subject, direct object, often with an initial conjunction. In my experience so far, I haven't seen very many Greek sentences that are that simple and have that word order. A lot of times they're different than that. So I didn't even know that until a couple of years ago, that there was a normal order. Okay, the lexical form of a noun is the nominative singular. Okay, familiar enough? Case endings, 6.12. Form. The following chart is called a paradigm. That's on page 40. The first paradigm is just the bare case endings. The second paradigm has the stem vowel attached to the case ending to show what it looks like. And then on the next page, 42, you've got the whole noun, the paradigm of the whole noun. That is with the nominative and accusative only. We haven't learned the genitive or dative yet. That's chapter 7. So those are called paradigms. A paradigm of a noun is called a declension. A paradigm of a verb is called a conjugation. And the word paradigm, para, means alongside of, it's a preposition. And dime, D-I-G-M, is a form of dignomy, and it means to show alongside of. So that's where you get the word paradigm. It's an orderly arrangement of all forms of the noun. Okay. It is the paradigm of the case endings used by the first and second declensions, nominative and accusative, and also singular and plural. He's explaining the form of this paradigm. The singular forms are on top and the plural below. You see the first four positions are singular, and on the bottom, those four are all plural. The order left to right is masculine, feminine, and neuter. That's the column headings, masculine, feminine, and neuter. And the 212 along the top means that the masculine follows the second declension, the feminine follows the first declension, and the neuter follows the second declension. He has a footnote on the word accusative in 612. If you've studied Greek before, you will notice a few differences. Just about every grammar teaches that the final stem vowel is part of the case ending, os and not sigma. Not only is this incorrect, but in my opinion, it makes learning Greek more difficult. If you learn the true case endings, you will find that memorization is kept to a minimum. He's got a very good point there. And when I learned Greek about 25 years ago, the book we used did just what he said.
Did he do this too? 'Cause I was in your second class for like 7 weeks or something.
Yeah.
And I think that I'm remembering os and on.
Okay. Well, if you remember that, we were probably using a book by Machen, which I didn't think I was using it.
The one I brought last week. It's the second edition.
Okay, that's Mounts, and he was saying the same thing then.
Okay.
Yeah.
Somewhere learned it wrong.
So that's the old school way of teaching.
Well, I'm real glad you brought it up because it's been in my head wrong. I need to unlearn it.
A dash, like you have in nominative singular feminine, do you see that? The middle column, first row. A dash means that no case ending is used and the stem of the noun stands by itself. So we'll see examples of that soon. The underlined alpha, and you see that in the neuter plural, both nominative and accusative, that means that the case ending joins with the final stem vowel. And footnote 6 says this is called a contraction. And I will discuss it in detail later. Yeah, we'll get into a chapter later on. It goes into a lot of detail about contractions.
Right, so now I've got a question then about the dash as opposed to the places where there is neither a letter nor a dash.
Okay.
Does that indicate, for instance, in the genitive and dative cases, that those follow the third declension? Or
no, we're just not studying.
No. No, the dash is...
That's no... That means that the stem is by itself.
That's correct.
But in the case of genitive and dative, where you have neither a dash nor a letter.
True.
Does that indicate that follows the third declension?
No. The reason those are blank is because we're not going to learn that till chapter 7.
Oh, okay. So there is actually something.
If you look.
This is just the partial.
Partial
paradigm, not the complete.
That's correct. If you look in chapter 7 on page 57. Okay, thank you.
It's the full paradigm.
Full paradigm. Yeah.
Okay.
It's filled in then. So let's not even think about
those two cases. Yeah, I was just trying to figure out what was the significance of the blank versus the dash.
Okay. Back to footnote 6. He'll discuss contraction in a later chapter. But for example, with these two that he's got, nominative and accusative plural neuter, the stem of the noun ergon is erga. When it is in the neuter plural, its form is erga. The omicron and alpha have contracted to alpha. Erga plus alpha becomes erga. That's called a contraction. And there's rules for contraction, but we'll talk about it later. So he lists the paradigm as far as we've gotten. Masculine, let's go vertically with this. Nominative singular is sigma. That's the true case ending. Accusative singular is nu. Nominative plural case ending is iota. Accusative plural masculine is upsilon sigma. Footnote 7 says the masculine accusative plural ending is actually nu sigma. Due to the nature of nu, it drops out. In order to compensate for the loss of the nu, the omicron of the stem lengthens to omicron upsilon when followed by a sigma. So it shows you the steps there of how it forms from the stem log a plus the true ending nu sigma becomes logos because the nu dropped out, and then it lengthens to logos. You don't have to remember all of those steps. He's just showing you how it got there. For me, it's easiest just to remember us is the true case ending for nominative masculine plural. Excuse me, accusative masculine plural. He's going to be doing this sort of thing from time to time, showing us how the different steps it changes from one form to another. He has written a book, I didn't bring it with me, where, and he's probably got more knowledge of that than anybody. And he explains the different forms that are unusual. All right, feminine, let's follow that vertically. Nothing for the nominative singular. That means that the stem of any word, which is feminine, second, first declension, in the nominative singular, it will be the whole word. That's the form of it. There is no case ending for that. But in the accusative singular feminine, nu is the case ending, just like with masculine. And it's easy too for nominative plural feminine. It's iota, just like it was for masculine. And with the accusative plural singular, accusative plural feminine, it's a sigma. So there's a pattern already. Now with neuter, there's a peculiarity with the neuter gender. The nominative and accusative will always match each other. That's true for all neuter nouns. And in the singular, it's nu for the case ending. In the plural, it's alpha for the case ending. But that alpha was formed by a contraction. So those are the true case endings. And he's trying to emphasize that he wants us to learn the true case ending, not the next paradigm, which has the stem vowel attached to it. When I learned it with a different book, we learned these endings with the stem vowel attached. But he's got a very good point that it holds down memory to a minimum if you can recognize the true case ending. He says, these case endings must be learned perfectly. This is the beginning of what I call the master case ending chart. The middle two cases will be learned in the next chapter.
So it's looking that it's looking like neuter is going to be a fun set of nouns to translate because the accusative and the nominative are identical.
Exactly. And we'll run into some verses probably pretty soon. Well, you have to make a judgment call. Is this the subject or is it the correct object? Because the form is identical.
I have a question.
Sure. It's
related to the next diagram where he shows the letters. That shows the vowel of the ending vowel of the stem.
That's right.
And in the feminine, the first declension, there is no eta ending. There is no eta. Eta iota. It's only alpha iota and alpha sigma. So is that contracted?
No. Good observation.
Where is it then?
He'll explain it a little bit later, but there's two different forms of a feminine noun for the singular. Some of them have eta as the connecting vowel. Others have alpha as the connecting vowel. But in the plural, they always have alpha as the connecting vowel.
Well, okay, that's a confusing. So do we have an example of a noun that's
yes.
a feminine noun?
Yes. Here, look at the next page.
We have some.
Page 42 on the top. We're jumping ahead just a little, but it's a good thing to look at, I think. Graphe is.
Yes, I'm sorry, but it looks like it contracted. It got rid of the. I mean, I don't care what word you use, but there is no graph. There's no graph. The form of graphe becomes an alpha iota and an alpha sigma. The eta is dropped.
Yes.
It's gone.
It's dropped because in the plural, all feminine first declension nouns have a connecting vowel alpha, not eta.
Okay, we're using different words.
Yeah.
But it's doing the same thing that the neuter did with the omicron. I've been ahead. I'm trying to recognize words by these endings. And you'll never find an iota alpha sigma. I mean, it's always alpha sigma. And to recognize the word with the root, I had to realize the eta went away. So, yeah. I mean, he doesn't say that
eta,
anywhere.
Eta and alpha are related.
Well, okay.
And the peculiarity of this word is that in the plural, the alpha replaces the eta. It's not, it doesn't contract with all anything, right. It just replaces it. But in the case of the erga, that was formed by contraction.
So does that mean that, I hear that. Does that mean that there are manuscripts which actually have an omicron alpha ending for the neuters? Is there some ancient manuscript where it wasn't contracted?
I don't think so.
Well, that, okay.
Because contraction is something that was ancient. In other words, these...
I mean, it's sort of a curiosity that we're using different words for what appears to be the same thing. Functionally, we'll never see a neuter word that's omicron alpha. It'll be alpha alone.
I think that's true.
I mean, I'm by what he's told us here.
Yeah.
And what I'm seeing in these examples is we'll never see a feminine word that's iota alpha. So in any either case, the important thing is to recognize that that's true. And when we're looking at these words that end in an alpha ending, they're a neuter word that originally had an omicron stem, and in its lexical form it's got an omicron new.
That's correct.
But in the lexical form of the feminine, it'll be an iota. Yeah. I mean an eta. It'll be an eta in the lexical form, but when we see it you know in its plural forms, will be an alpha iota or an alpha sigma. That's the thing. He doesn't say that real clearly. So.
I guess he didn't. But I'm telling you that, well, he does have, I did read something.
Yeah, he does.
Just a minute.
Kind of hidden.
I found it just for
it's in the example there.
6.16. Yeah, there it is. In the paradigm, there are two feminine nouns, graphe and hora. The only difference between the forms of these two words is the final stem vowel. Graphe ends with an eta and hora ends with an alpha. If you think of the alpha and eta as being related vowels, then you will not have to learn two different patterns for feminine nouns. They are identical except for the final stem vowel. He says it a different way than I did. My way of thinking of it is that in the plural, any feminine first declension noun that has a final stem vowel of eta in the lexical form, it will change to alpha in the plural.
Yeah,
because there are no cases where a plural feminine first declension noun has an eta. They're all alpha, whether they started off with an eta or not.
Right.
I have a suspicion that the contraction talked about in footnote 6 with the Omicron becoming the alpha,
yeah,
or being replaced by the alpha is a linguistic concern.
Yes, I think so.
Because eta and alpha are very close to each other,
yes,
in terms of mouth shape, right? Whereas Omicron is pretty far away, relatively speaking.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, because
so I would imagine. So, yeah, I would imagine contraction, because you see this sort of thing in a lot of languages where a linguist will hypothesize that there was probably this form at some point based on the logic of the system, like, but it's not really pronounceable, so you don't do
it. Yeah, hard to pronounce. Yeah,
right.
Yeah,
contractions always come into languages for pronounceability. I mean, people. Well, let's say, I just did it.
Yeah.
It comes out as a contraction because it's so difficult to stop and start, let us.
Yeah.
So it comes out as let's. So in every language, contractions evolve that same way, and they exist before they're ever written down.
Mm-hmm.
It's just trying to represent on paper what people are actually saying for pronounceability.
Good point.
Well, I would suspect the change from iota to alpha doesn't count as contraction because it's not enough of a shift. I bet it's an academic distinction. He says he'll explain it later, though.
Yeah. All right. Well, I interrupted where we were, I think. So let's go back. okay. As you can see, last line of page 40, as you can see, we have to make allowance for the two stem vowels in the feminine singular. That's why he has two columns in the singular for the feminine, but only one column in the plural, because they're all going to be alpha, iota, and alpha, sigma. Are we clear enough on that now?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. 613, somebody want to read?
I can read.
Right.
The masculine and feminine case endings are often similar or even identical. In the nominative and accusative, the neuter is usually distinct from the masculine. In the neuter, the nominative and accusative singular are always the same. In the nominative and accusative plural are always the same. Context will usually show you whether the neuter word is the subject or direct object.
Yeah. Now, I like the fact he says always. It follows that pattern. The nominative and accusative are always the same, whether it's singular or plural. And context will usually show you. Well, there are some places in the New Testament where it's hard to determine whether it's going to be a subject or a direct object. But that's context is our friend. It's going to help us decide how to translate in most cases. There's sometimes when it's going to be hard, but that's a reliable guide.
Is this a, this might be jumping ahead, but are the adjectives going to help us out at all? Are they distinct for the nominative, accusative, neuter?
Well, yes, but what helps you even more than adjectives is the article.
Mm, okay.
And yeah. I'll show you here real quick. I'm going to go to chapter 7 because it has a full paradigm of the article. On page 57, 7.10, this is the full paradigm of the article. And there are very few that are, they're in the masculine genitive singular is two, and the neuter genitive singular is two. Those are duplicates. Also, the dative singular of masculine and neuter, they're identical. Mm-hmm. And the genitive plural of all three genders is identical. The dative plural of masculine and neuter are duplicates. But those are the only duplications. All the rest are unique forms of the article. And so when you have the article attached to the noun, And the term for that is an articular noun. Mm. Then that article will help you very much to decide how to translate it.
In the case of this neuter, the article for singular is ta, and it's ta for plural. Yeah. So it's the same problem with neuter. We can't tell.
That's right. But
tricky.
The article, he makes a statement somewhere along the line, the article is our friend. It solves a problem more than the noun. That's just how to translate it.
It's almost as if the article is an auxiliary declension, almost. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right. Continue reading, please.
6:14, important. Learn the case endings. Without them, you will never be able to translate anything. Be sure to memorize the endings by themselves, not only what they look like when attached to a word. Otherwise, you may not be able to identify the endings on other nouns. The key to learning these paradigms is to realize that translation does not require you to repeat paradigm. It requires you to recognize the endings when you see them. The case endings are, in a sense, triggers showing you the function of the word in a sentence. I suggest that you read the paradigms left to right, not top to bottom. When you are translating a verse, you will be looking for a word in the nominative. And at first, you do not care about its number or gender.
Let me stop you there for a second. When we get into translating the exercises, I suggest, and I'm going to try to repeat this as we do quite often. I suggest we look for the subject first, find the nominative case, because in English, most of our sentences start with the subject. So since word order is not as important in Greek as it is to us in English, we might have to look toward the end of the sentence to find the subject. So that's the first step. Next step is probably to find the words that are connected with that subject. In other words, an article or an adjective that goes with it, the modifiers.
So is this why, sorry to interrupt.
Yeah, please.
This is why he tells you to read this paradigm horizontally, not vertically.
Yeah.
Because he wants you to think about nominative as a set.
Yeah.
So that you can do things exactly what you're describing. Mm-hmm. You look at a sentence and find whatever it is that's in nominative.
Yeah.
Okay. That thank you. That
helps you.
It put something together for me. Yeah. Okay. Like, I didn't get why. Because I guess I took Spanish in like community college. And, you know, for verb conjugations or whatever, you take a verb, here's all of the conjugations of that verb, we memorize that. That's on a flashcard. Next verb, you know.
Yeah.
But that's very different, I think.
Yeah, and if you think about it, when you're reading a sentence in English, the first thing you think of is, what is it about? Mm-hmm. And then after you know what it's about, your next question is, what happened?
Mm-hmm.
So it's only after that that you start thinking about all those other things to refine it.
Yeah. So, in fact, I think he made a point already, when babies learn a language, they start with the noun system. They want to know, what's this, what's that? Then, after they get used to that, they learn about action words.
Yeah. That's mine.
I missed that. I'm sorry, Ed.
I was joking. They learn the words they learn real quickly, where it's like no.
Oh yeah, yeah.
They learn the possessive early.
Yeah. That's right. Okay, continue, please.
Use flashcards. Put each ending on a different card. Carry them with you wherever you go. Mix them up and review them over and over again.
By the way, I see all your flashcards there. I'm going to brag on Dave a little bit.
No.
He came in and he didn't know what I had given as an assignment, which I didn't really give an assignment because we weren't finished reading the chapter yet. So he went ahead, finished reading the chapter, and did all the exercises. And he told me about, he had trouble with one of them, and we figured it out before the rest of you got here. But Dave's doing a slam up job already. And as far as I can tell, he's probably the senior member of the class besides me.
You just set me up for a fall, Carl.
Did I? Yeah. Well, the two finalists in the previous class I taught started off with 15 approximately. And there were a lot of young people in that class. There was one 14-year-old and two 15-year-olds starting out. And the two ladies that finished up the class were both grandmothers, and they were lamenting the fact when they started that we can't keep up with these young minds. We can't remember as well. Maybe so. I relate to that too, but they were, it was like the tortoise and the hare. One by one, everybody else dropped out of the class, and these two ladies finished up, and they finished so well. There's very few classes I've carried all the way through to the end of the book, but that was the one. And those two are also the ones that published that book for me, that, and it just blew me out of the saddle. But so Dave, you're to be commended highly, I think. You're working hard. You probably have to work harder than any of the rest of us, but you're doing it. So.
I have a smart son, so that makes up for my
whatever you have to use. Okay, finish the last one there.
Always say the endings out loud. The more senses you employ in memorization, the better. Mm-hmm. Pronounce the ending out loud. Listen to yourself speak. Write the ending down. Look at what should happen.
Footnote 8.
I have not yet found a way to eat flash. Excuse me. To eat flashcards. And so taste the meaning. But that would be 5 cents.
Smell the words.
Okay. Oh my
goodness. You see, I don't see so well. I look red flesh there.
Okay. I don't know whether you are the senior member of the class, Dave.
That's fine.
The point is you're working hard, and I appreciate it.
Okay.
Next page. This is the whole noun with both the true ending, the connecting vowel, which, or the stem vowel is another term, which is part of the stem and the whole word. Let's do it horizontally, like he suggested.
You want to read that, lead up to that? Or
no? Let's read it together. Okay. Logos, graphe, hora, ergon. That's nominative. Now accusative singular, logon, raphane, horon, ergon. Then nominative plural, logoi, raphai, horai, erga, logus, raphas, horas, erga. Now, did you notice that the accent stayed on the same syllable throughout? That's a characteristic of nouns. As much as the rules of accenting will allow, they tend to have a tend to keep the accent on the same vowel. There are rules, though, that won't permit it to be done everywhere, but it tries to stay on this. It has a permanent position for the accent. Each noun does. That's not true of verbs. Verbs try to put the accent as far back from the end as they can, as far as the rules of accenting will permit. But that's just a side note. Notice which endings are going to give you trouble. The nu and the alpha occur in several places. The nu occurs in both neuter singular cases. It also occurs in the accusative of the masculine and feminine. Mm-hmm. The alpha occurs in the plural of the neuters. It also occurs in the feminine singular of the types of nouns that have an alpha stem vowel, connecting vowel or stem vowel. So, but if we learn those true case endings perfectly, which we're going to try to do, I think I'll, when we get finished with reading the book for chapter 7, I'll give a quiz on those case endings and also for the article at the same time. Those are things that are very important to memorize.
When is that? When is that quiz going to happen?
Not for another few weeks.
Okay.
By the way, let me mention this too. I told Dave this, but the pattern I'd like to follow is to read the entire chapter first before we start doing the exercises. And then whether I say it or not, as soon as we finish reading that chapter in the textbook, the assignment will be to do at least a portion of the exercises. We're already taking more time at the beginning than I hope to do later on. I want to speed up once we're comfortable enough. I'm not going to do it too soon. But in order to make it not drag on so long, I'd like to eventually get to where we can do 2 weeks per chapter. Right now, we're in our second week of chapter 6, but this is one of the longest chapters and very foundational, chapters 6 and 7. So I'm not going to rush these. 6.16, feminine. In the paradigm, there are two feminine nouns. Oh, we read this, didn't we? Is it understandable what now, Dave, why there's two different forms in the singular feminine? Some nouns have an alpha and some have an eta as the stem vowel. But all of them.
Yeah, they all are plural in alpha.
Yeah, all of the plurals have.
I followed that. Yeah. It's more that I was clarifying because he spreads that information out in a way that's not completely obvious.
Yeah. And by the way, this is the fourth edition. I've had all four editions, and the first editions, every time it changes and gets a little better and a little better. It corrects errors and he presents truth in a different way, but it's evolving.
I'm sure this is all helpful. I'll be honest with these declensions. I made my flashcards the way I made them, and I didn't do it the way he did it because I find this very confusing.
Okay.
I just did each. I did put them together, but I have the first declension and the second declension, and I'm showing the masculine and the neuter separately. And I'm memorizing them by going through, because the thing that's confusing to me as I first started looking at this, and now I'm beginning to get it now that I've actually done some of the translations, that when I look at that and say, well, I'm supposed to read across and I'm looking at completely different words, it just doesn't make any sense at all.
Whatever makes sense to
me.
To you,
I mean, I'm just sharing that because, and now that I get it, I'm going, okay, sure, that's the way I approach translating. I'm trying to find the subject and versus the object, and then I'm looking for the number.
Mm-hmm.
I'm recognizing the gender based on, I'm really finding the vowel that's in there to find the gender, but the gender is not what's important to me. It's, you know, what he said is true. It just was hard to kind of memorize it that way.
Okay. Each of us has a different way of learning things, and I learn more from visual and writing things down, and it takes me a long time to learn something new. Probably when I was younger, I could do things quicker, but each of us has our own style of learning. So find what works best for you.
So just to,
yeah,
you know, I'm assuming that this kind of gets into a vocabulary memorization issue, but let's say I was looking at a sentence, you know, if I see an Omicron nu as the last two letters of some noun, it could be, it could be neuter, you know, nominative or accusative.
Yeah.
And it could be masculine accusative.
Right.
And I would just have, you just have to know the
vocabulary. Yeah.
Being.
Yeah.
The article will tell you if it's there.
The article will help you. But the article in the neuter does the same little thing that the noun does. Yeah. So you still
the
have
difference between the neuter,
the masculine and article.
Masculine article. Right. Okay. Hot. It'd be, hot. Okay, I forget what it is. Sorry. I have that on me.
Okay.
Thank you.
That's how, I guess that's Tom, what I was saying. Tom. It's like the article functions almost like an auxiliary declension because it fills in the gaps that the that the initial declension doesn't.
Right. So if I saw define ta and then the noun, I know I'm dealing with neuter, but if I saw ton, then it's masculine.
That's right. Okay. Cool. Notice, however, that in the pluralist stem of graphe ends in alpha and not eta. All first declension nouns that have eta in the singular shift to alpha in the plural. Or I use the word, not replaced by alpha. But yeah, there's a shift in the vowel. Okay. 617. Could I have somebody else read for a bit?
Sure. Parse. When asked to parse a noun, you should specify five things about the word. The case, such as nominative or accusative. The number, singular or plural. Gender, such as masculine, feminine, or neuter. Lexical form, which is always the nominative singular.
That's right.
And the inflected meaning.
Yeah, in other words, how do you translate it in this sentence?
For example, la goose is accusative plural masculine from lagos, meaning words.
Mm-hmm.
This is only my suggestion. Teachers may vary on their preferred order of parsing.
I've got a preferred order. I have to confess, I left home too quickly and I forgot to bring some of the things that I wanted to bring, but I have a parsing code that I use, and at some point I'll give it to you. It's an abbreviated way of parsing, and we can use my. I've got an order too that I prefer, and I think it might be good if you join me.
Not like a standard parsing order that's commonly accepted by linguists.
Could be. I don't know what that standard is. I know what his preferred method is. Now, if you look on, you know, I made you copies of the exercises, and he has a chart here under parsing.
Oh, perfect.
And his order is case, number, gender, lexical form, and inflected meaning. I think that's the same order that he has in 617.
Mm-hmm. And I'm assuming usually those are abbreviated to single letters.
Yes.
I usually have seen it done.
For instance, this first one on the exercise sheet. We lost Ed. Anthropon. Mm-hmm. The case of that, see the new on the end that tells you it's nominative singular.
Mm-hmm.
So that would be N for case, S for number. And the gender, the way I know that it's masculine is because in the vocabulary section, I learned it as a masculine noun because it has the ha form of the article along with it.
Mm-hmm.
Did you mean to say accusative?
You said nominative.
Did I? I'm sorry. Accusative. You're right.
Okay.
Yeah, anthropos is nominative. Yeah, I'll make mistakes, and I welcome you to catch me and correct me. I didn't mean to say nominative. It is accusative, singular, and masculine. It's the gender. Because in the vocabulary section of the chapter, it will have the ha along with the noun. Mm. And the ha tells you that it's masculine. The lexical form then is anthropos, because it's always going to be nominative singular. And the inflected meaning is man, but it's man used as a direct object, not as a subject. Does that make sense to you?
Mm-hmm.
So let's do, well, no, not yet. Not yet.
And if this is,
please do.
So on the, when we're talking about gender, for the most part, we're talking grammatical gender, right?
Like that's the, right. The gender, it like might not be natural gender.
It might not necessarily make sense to what we guess.
Right.
But if it is something like if you were saying man or woman, is there just a different word for woman? In mm-hmm. other words, like a, there wouldn't be a feminine inflection of anthropos that would.
No. We might think of this word anthropos as mankind. You know, in written literature, they'll quite often say man or him, meaning him or her. Mm-hmm. Feminists don't like that, but that's the way it's been for centuries.
Yeah.
English did the same thing, and in the translation from the Greek into the English, it's the same rule. Whenever a word is needed to represent a human being, it's always the male.
Mm-hmm. Now there is another word on air, which means male, mm-hmm. male, and the woman is gune, from which we get the word gynecology. On air, andros. You've heard android.
Right, but those previous two words you're about, that would be just male and female.
That's right.
Man and woman.
That's right.
Right. Oh. So you can't just tell, does anthropos mean a man or a person? The context should tell us.
Right.
Yeah.
Now, in our translation, you could often use the word man, meaning mankind.
Yeah.
Or you could use the word person. As we get into the exercises, that'll become apparent.
If I may, this is, I think, really exciting. So I thought I'd share. This is already really useful to studying the Bible. I use this, just the parsing shorthand all of the time, because mm-hmm. there's a standard parsing shorthand for interlinear translations.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
So if you look at, if you just pull up the free interlinear translation on Bible Hub, for example, with Greek chapters, they will include the parsing information at the bottom of each word. And I'm looking at the first couple of words of Matthew 1:1, and we have n-nfs, which is biblios, which is a noun, dash, and then the parsing information is its nominative, feminine, and singular.
Mm-hmm. There you go. Yeah, and I have my favorite lexicon that I use has a card in it that has their parsing code, and it's very thorough. It's got a lot of letters in there that I've never had to use, but I've got my own parsing code that suits me, and it's very close to what he's the order mm-hmm. that he's using here.
Can you give that to me one more time? So yeah. I see n-nsf. So
yeah, it's a noun.
Yeah.
Oh,
and the noun is nominative, feminine, and singular.
Nominative,
singular. Mm-hmm.
So okay. It is the subject of the sentence.
What threw me is that this, and it seems like the stem ends with an omicron, but this is feminine?
Apparently,
I don't know. Is the word?
Biblos.
Biblos.
Biblos. Yeah, I can't remember that
word. So it is.
Is it feminine?
It seems to say that in this, but.
Well, we can look up Strong's.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, Strong's is
says it's feminine. Okay. They have biblos, biblo, and bible.
Okay, so it's the letters by case, gender, and number.
Yes.
Yep.
That's how they're doing it in the interlinear. Yeah.
Yep. All right. So if that comes up in a Bible study, already what we've learned in Greek has been useful.
Yeah, we know that now. Gender. Okay, cool.
Well, that's the same order they do here, case number, gender.
Yeah. Right. In our textbook, back in the gray-edged pages, on page 480, you've got biblos. Hey.
We do.
See the hey there? That's the feminine form of the article. Which tells you that is a feminine noun, but it's an oddball. It's a second declension feminine noun. There are a few exceptions to the rule, and this is one of them.
Cool.
The connecting vowel is omicron, even though it is a feminine noun.
Where are you at?
Page 480, down near the bottom, biblos.
This is a lexicon.
Yes, it's an abbreviated lexicon. It's more complete than if it's more than all the vocabulary sections. This goes down to a frequency count of 10, I believe. Biblos and biblu, that u ending is a genitive singular. We'll talk about that in chapter 7. But the hey is the feminine form of the article, lexical form of the feminine.
So
that indicates it's a feminine noun, but it's got an omicron stem vowel.
So how do we, whatever the right word is, decline this? How do we?
Let's hold off on that.
Okay. Sorry. Anything that we know yet.
That's right.
All right.
Anyway, I just thought I'd point out that this is something I'm already using in Bible studies.
Yes, very good.
And it's exciting stuff.
Good observation. Okay. Parsing neuter nouns. When parsing a neuter word that is either nominative or accusative, my suggestion is to list both possibilities. For example, ergon is nominative or accusative, singular neuter from ergon, meaning work. So I would use the abbreviations N/A, meaning nominative or accusative, singular, it can't be plural, and then neuter, abbreviation S for singular, N for neuter. All right. I'm sorry, I took over reading again. Would you continue reading?
Fine. Picking up the top of page 43. When you are translating a sentence and come across one of these forms, it is important to see that the word can be either the subject or the direct object. If you make an assumption that it is the subject when, in fact, it is the direct object, you may never be able to translate the sentence. But if you are accustomed to parsing it as nominative/accusative, you will be less likely to make this mistake. 6.19. Indeclinable. Some words in Greek are indeclinable, such as some personal names and words borrowed from other languages. Their form, therefore, does not change regardless of their meaning or function in the sentence. For example, the word Israel, Israel, whether it is the subject or the direct object.
Yeah. The name Jesus, Jesus, is nominative singular. Jesu is genitive singular. Jesun is accusative singular. And I think dative and genitive for the name Jesus are identical.
So the names are inflected also?
Some names are. Some are partially declinable. Some are indeclinable.
Oh, boy. Is that just something you have to learn arbitrarily, or is there a pattern to it?
There's no rhyme or reason that I can tell.
You just have to memorize them all, individual.
So some are irregular, some are just, they don't even try.
Okay. Fascinating. What if it's related to the importance of the Jesus's name? It's so important. Well, I can say they worked out declensions for
it. Well, here's something that'll help with Jesus's name. The word Christ, which is often included with Jesus, it's fully declined.
Right.
So Christos, nominative singular masculine, Christu, genitive singular masculine, Christo, dative singular masculine, and Christon, accusative singular masculine. So with Jesus Christ, even though genitive and dative of Jesus is identical, the Christos, which is almost always there, will help you there. Plus the article, you know, names quite often have the article. So the article will help you. It shouldn't be any problem.
Right.
First three noun rules.
6.20. These are the first three of the famous eight noun rules. Famous or infamous.
Yeah.
Memorize them precisely. Stems ending in alpha or eta are in the first declension. Stems ending in omicron are in the second, and consonantal stems are in the third.
We have not gotten to consonantal stems, but that's chapter 10. And so far, we've got a stem vowel as the last letter of the stem. But some nouns, a lot of nouns actually, don't have a vowel as the ending letter. So those are third declension.
Number two, every neuter word has the same form in the nominative and accusative. Number three, almost all neuter words end in alpha in the nominative and accusative plural.
And in addition to that, even third declension nouns will end in alpha in the neuter plural. And he's got a total of eight noun rules, and they're in the appendix in that gray edge page section. Okay, article. Here we go. This is important. Somebody else want to read about that?
I can read. The definite article is the only article in Greek. There is no indefinite article. For this reason, you can refer to the Greek definite article simply as the article. The article agrees with the word it modifies in case, number, and gender. For this reason, unlike nouns, the article can occur in any gender. In other words, if a noun is nominative, singular, masculine,
anthropos.
The article that modifies it will be nominative, singular, masculine.
Ha. That's a rough breathing.
The lexical form of the article is the nominative, singular, masculine. As a general rule, the lexical form of any word that occurs in more than one gender is the masculine form.
Yeah. That will occur in the parsing section. If you look at page 11 in the handout I gave you, for instance, number 6, ta. Well, that could be nominative or accusative. So you would put n/a in under case for that. You'd have singular, that would be an s. And you'd have neuter, n, for the gender. But lost track. The lexical form of that would be ha, because that's the masculine singular form. The reason for that is if you're going to look that word up, ta, in any lexicon, you would not look under T for ta. You'd look under Omicron or ha. That's where you'd find it. And the meaning is the. Okay. Continue.
Here's the paradigm of the article. Compare the forms to the case endings to see all the similarities.
Okay.
The form of the article follows the first declension, the masculine, and you're the second.
So if you wanted to compare that paradigm with the one on.
He has it right there.
Does he have it?
Yeah, the one on the right is the ending. I found that confusing, so I just wrote in my text, this is the
yeah, that's what we've learned. But see the similarities. Now here's something that he might not. Oh yeah, he does say it under hints. So we won't bother reading this paradigm, but go on to 6.24, please.
Man, the article begins with either a rough breathing or a ta. Then you have the characteristic vowel of that declension and the case ending, except the neuter singular.
Yeah. See, neuter singular with the noun, it would be a nu. But on the article, it's an omicron. It's just the stem vowel without a case ending. Footnote 9.
You want to read footnote 9?
Yeah, might as well.
The vowel in the feminine article is always eta in the singular, never alpha, as can be the case with nouns. The nominative singular is easy to memorize. In the feminine and masculine, there is no case ending and no tau. The vowel stands alone, and since you have already associated the eta, first declension, and omicron second, you already know these forms that note the breathing. The neuter article could not follow suit, otherwise it would be identical to the masculine. Therefore, you have characteristic tau followed by the omicron that you associate with the second declension. In both the masculine and feminine, the nominative plural endings are a vowel followed by an iota. Again, you see the characteristic omicron and alpha. If you learn that the vowel iota combination indicates nominative plural, then if it is boy,
yeah,
the word is masculine. And if it is
I,
the word is feminine.
Now, he didn't put the rough breathing there because he's just talking about the.
So it would be
hoy. Yeah. But look up
polloi,
there.
Right?
I'm sorry?
The hoy polloi.
Yeah. Hoi polloi means the masses, or
when we first encountered the hoi, I was like, that's a Greek phrase.
But
I hadn't thought of that.
I want to show you another pattern. Maybe he already said it, but the nominative singular for both masculine and feminine have a rough breathing and no tau. The nominative plural for both masculine and feminine have a rough breathing and no tau, but all the rest of them have a tau. Right. Tau. So those patterns help me to remember. I'll continue then.
Okay. So is that tain?
Yeah, tain.
Tain and
ton
are exactly alike, except that the feminine has an eta and the masculine has. In the accusative plural, you have the characteristic omicron and alpha. You will discover that the vowel
plus sigma,
vowel sigma combination is typical for the accusative plural, and the alpha is common in neuter plural words.
So, but it's omicron upsilon. The accusative plural omicron doesn't stand alone. It's followed by, you have the omicron, but then it's upsilon sigma.
Yeah.
So this statement's kind of not accurate.
Not totally, but remember he told us already the true ending for accusative plural masculine was nu sigma. Remember we...
Upsilon sigma?
No, new.
Put a note about the contract.
Yeah.
What?
Footnote 7 back on page 40.
Page 40. Masculine accusative plural ending is actually nu sigma. Due to the nature of nu, it drops out. In order to compensate for the loss of the nu, the omicron stem lengthens to omicron upsilon when followed by a sigma.
This is like information that's background that's really not in any of the text we're looking at.
True.
So I'm not really, when trying to give us hints that are helpful, I don't know how that helps.
Well,
It's telling us something that isn't apparent, and you'd have to have other information that's hidden from us.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like it's stuff that when you find something later on that matches this, then you've got to figure out where to go back to here to find the explanation.
It's not a helpful statement because it doesn't follow what we're seeing.
I agree with you. So
it may be helpful, but helpful later on.
Yeah,
I don't know. The accusative masculine plural is the omicron plus upsilon sigma.
Meaning no disrespect to mounts, but we have Carl.
Yes.
Well, I'm telling you, he's going to do this sort of thing a lot. Yeah. Tell you how it gets from one point to another point, all the steps, but it isn't very helpful to me either, Dave.
Okay.
So I just memorize.
Yeah.
Twos.
I bring up the question because it's like, is there something I'm missing here?
No.
It's out of context.
Or is it just an error in his writing?
Not an error.
Okay.
But
it's out of context.
Yeah.
More than you need.
Once you have the context, it'll make sense. Yeah. But we don't have the context.
Yeah.
Okay, it's
more than you need to know at this point, in my opinion.
I mean, you pointed back to page 40, and I still don't follow how that relates to this, but that's okay.
Okay, just remember that. See, it's hard for me to see distinguish between blue and black, but upsilon sigma, I believe, is blue.
Yes,
that's considered that combination as the ending, the true ending.
Yes.
Oh my goodness, they're two different colors.
They are.
They are. Back in my glass.
Well, I can't see it. You're kind of in a shadow, too, over there.
I turned it so that I got the light hitting.
You can move it under.
It's a bright light to be able to see.
On the view. Okay, sorry. Totally missed that. Okay.
It's hard. let me show you something.
In bold, larger print.
It wouldn't have gone with his motif, but I feel like red would have been a better color.
Well, can you see this?
I got it.
It is red there.
He
probably had a lot of complaints about that blue.
Oh, is that a product of his too?
That's a product of his, yeah.
Oh.
I only got this real recently. That's a lot more information than you need right now. But it is very useful.
I sure miss the Christian bookstore.
Well, you can probably order this through wherever you got the book.
Yeah, when I got that one, it wasn't on back order.
So that was the one thing you got.
Yeah.
Footnote 10.
That was the first thing to come in.
Okay. Read the next square bullet point, please.
The article does not care about the declension of the word is modifying. What is that?
Hey.
A will modify a feminine noun, whether it is first or second declension.
Or third declension.
But there are 10 we have not seen any of those nouns, I guess.
So is may I just ask if biblos is a second declension feminine
noun? Yes. It's a second declension feminine noun.
Mostly.
Yeah.
Well, He has presented this as if first declension is feminine, second declension is masculine or neuter. But that's not really true.
Well,
these
there
are
exceptions.
Are followed, and then there's masculine or feminine, which is really a different thing. Although most of them fit in this.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
There's also first declension masculine nouns.
Okay.
All right. Okay. So, all right.
This makes the article consistent, easy to learn, and important.
Yeah.
Okay,
then he's got another paradigm with the article attached to the noun. That's the full paradigm so far without genitive and dative. 626.
Knowing the forms of the article is a key to recognizing the forms of nouns in Greek. If you learn the forms of the Greek article well, you will not have much more to learn about nouns. Almost all nouns are preceded by the article. If you cannot decline a noun, the article will help. Most of the case endings found on nouns are similar in form to the article. Therefore, if you know the article, you know many of the case endings.
I don't know if he says it in this ending edition of the book, but in the other editions, he said, the article is our friend. If you learn it well, that'll help you untie many knots in translation.
But only certain nouns will get an article.
He says most of them will.
Most of them will, okay.
Yeah. There's two terms that you'll probably pick up on. An articular noun is one that has the article. An anarthrous noun is one that does not have the article. Okay, footnote 11.
Parse and decline are basically synonyms. I only use decline in conjunction with the noun system. We use conjugate with verbs.
Yeah. And I think I already mentioned a paradigm. You can have a paradigm for verbs, and that's called a conjugation. Paradigm for nouns is called a declension. All right. Translation procedure. Somebody else want to read?
I can read if it's not annoying. When students start learning Greek, one of their initial problems is that a Greek sentence looks like a collection of unrelated words. One of the keys to solving this problem is to split a sentence into its different parts. At this point, you can separate the subject and the direct object from the verb. Theos.
Sose.
Sose.
Sukas.
Sukas. God will save souls. The subject, Theos, and the direct object is thukos. Mm-hmm. Am I missing a letter?
It's a psukos. C is a combination of a P and an S. Psukos.
Okay. You would divide the sentence like this. Theos, so say.
Yeah. Psukos.
If the article is present, keep it with the noun. Ho theos.
Ha theos.
Ha theos.
So say sukas.
As you get further into Greek, sentence structure becomes more complex. I will eventually introduce you to the wonderful world of phrasing, my absolutely most favorite exegetical tool. Article. As in English, the Greek article is generally translated the. The general rule is to translate according to the presence or absence of the article. If the article is present, translate it. If there is no article, do not use the. If there is no article, you may insert a before the noun if it makes better sense in English. For example, ha on huh?
Anthropos
means the man, and anthropos means man or a man.
I'd like to stop you for a second.
This is now just making me think of translating Neil Armstrong's first words on the moon into Greek. Nobody knows.
Okay, you. Man. you just read the.
You might have to say for the man.
For me, I'm still.
The previous paragraph there. If the article is present, translate it. If there is no article, do not use the. He said that's a general rule. There are some cases where you would be permitted to translate the article when there is none in the Greek. For instance, in a prepositional phrase, quite often they'll say for man. That's not the best preposition to use. To man, T-O, man. Mm. You could translate it to the man, put another, apply the word the. That's because prepositional phrases, the noun, which is the object of the prepositional phrase, is definite. It is already definite because of it being a prepositional phrase. So that's one case where there is no article in the Greek, but you're permitted to supply it. But be very careful about supplying the article in other cases. There are good reasons for doing it sometimes, but be very cautious of supplying the article when it's not there in the Greek. But on the other hand, sometimes if the article is there, you don't want to translate it, like with names. You wouldn't say the Dave, you'd say Dave. There's other times when...
Not unless there was more than one Dave and you were trying to find which Dave it was.
Okay. The Dave that has the orange shirt. That's right. Yeah. Yeah. That's right. Yeah, you have to...
We already do that in modern Turkish Greek. So it's El Lebanon. So they say the Lebanon, but we just say the country's Lebanon.
Mm-hmm.
So it's...
I remember back some years when FSU wanted to change their logo to say the Florida State University. That didn't catch on.
I'm looking at his footnote 12, which he didn't read yet.
Oh. Greek nouns are definite in and of themselves and do not require the article in order to be translated with the. Be careful of using a too frequently.
I'm not quite sure what that's really saying.
I'm not really sure either, Dave.
Okay.
Let's hold that in abeyance until we get to a specific exercise.
I found it helpful last week, though, when you had delineated how to pronounce the and the.
Okay.
And well, A and N I knew, but I'd never heard that,
with the and D.
Yes, I'd never heard that. And I found that just so logical. And I don't know, there's so many gaps in my education. You could, drive a spaceship through and explore new areas and dimensions of the universe. But
aren't we all like that, Tom?
But I found that incredibly helpful. Okay. And I guess what I'm saying is I'm picking up that there's a sense of that here too, where it's not just context, it's also the word order. And since they don't really use sentences like we do, it's all the phrasing and the causes or whatever. I found that interesting.
I see what he's saying in footnote 12. He goes back up to the second paragraph in 6.28, where he's saying, you're never ever going to see the indefinite article that we would use as a in Greek because it doesn't exist. So put it in there if you think it belongs. But then what he's saying down in 12 is sometimes Greek nouns that when they won't have the article actually would have the indefinite article with it. Would have a definite article with it. So be careful with using it when you're translating into English, putting an A there because it might be.
Your statement makes perfectly good sense, but he doesn't say that.
Don't overuse.
Yeah.
Be careful because you might be tempted to overuse A in your English translation.
What he says seems to be more absolute than what you just said.
Right.
Greek nouns are definite in and of themselves.
Right.
Which means that's much stronger than sometimes. He is right. sort of making a blanket statement that Greek nouns are always meant to be a definite specific thing.
Mm-hmm. Right. That contradicts whatever he says.
And I'm like, that's not matching anything else he said. So I'm not sure how to understand. That would make sense. No, you phrased it better.
Yeah.
That would make more sense. Okay. Gosh, no.
In the reading program, I'm using some students who are nowhere close to proficient. They're using things like the noun always comes before the verb. Well, we know that's not true across the board in English.
Yeah.
But in teaching them, we have to give them a starting point to recognize word order. If I start teaching them all the exceptions, they'll miss the 80% of the words and sentence structure that they can grasp more quickly.
Yeah.
They just won't understand Yoda when they watch Star Wars.
Right. I don't want Star Wars.
I think I remembered a verse in the King James translation of 1 Corinthians 15.
Oh.
Gives an example of what we're talking about. Verse 21, for since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection of the dead. That's not the best translation. The newer translations translate it, for since by a man came death. Well, that man was Adam. By a man also came the resurrection of the dead. Well, that man was Jesus. So it does make a difference in some cases.
That follows the sense of that verse because he talks about Adam specifically right before that, and Jesus specifically right before that, and that's like a summary statement.
Yeah, if you get the context, verse 20 says, "But now Christ is risen from the dead and become first fruits, then slept. For since by man came death, by man came also the resurrection. That for as in Adam all die." Even so in Christ.
I mean, but yes, those statements are true, but there's not the Greek. Does the Greek then miss the article in those? Actually,
probably has no article.
Yeah, which is
it has the preposition beta iota.
Well, you're looking at
just a minute.
I've got the interlinear up.
Well, I'm going to open mine for Corinthians. 15:21.
Oh no, I'm sorry, that's delta iota. D. Preposition chi.
Hold on a second.
Sure.
First Corinthians
15. Yeah. This is verse 21.
Yeah. D, that's a preposition. The apostrophe is an elision mark. The word is dia. Through a man. Yeah.
Okay.
Came death. And by the way, there's the article with Thanatos. You don't translate the article there. For since by a man came the death. No, just death. That's what you call a. I forget the word now.
Quick clarifying question. The article does always precede the noun that it belongs to. So that is an instance where word order is.
I think you're correct.
What verse is it?
21.
Oh.
Right. Yeah.
Hmm.
So there is no article in front of anthropou. But that's probably because it's. A prepositional phrase, but that's a case.
What's that? Oh, that's genitive. We haven't gotten that case yet.
Okay. Well, we've gotten far afield.
Sorry.
I'd like to finish this at least through. I was hoping to get through the chapter.
We're almost there.
Okay. Let me read if you don't mind.
Sure.
Where are we? I've lost my place. 629. You'll soon discover that the Greek did not use the article the same way we do. They used it when we never would, and they omitted it when the English demands it. Languages are not codes, and there is not an exact word-for-word correspondence. Therefore, you should be flexible at this point. You will meet the following two differences in this chapter. Footnote 13, see chapter 36 for more discussion on the article. By the way, I've got a book here called Greek Grammar Beyond the Basics by Dan Wallace. And he devotes two whole chapters to the use and non-use of the article. It's a very complex subject. At this point, we don't need to know all of that stuff, but be careful with your use, your translation of the article. We'll talk about it as things come up. That paragraph I just read is a very important paragraph. Languages are not codes, so we can't plug one word into another word because, you know, we have idiomatic expressions in all languages. And an idiom is a word phrase that doesn't mean what it literally says. So we have it in our language too. Greek, no. The same holds true. Greek often uses the article before a proper name. For example, you will generally find ha Iesus, the Jesus. You may omit the article in your translation of proper names. The same holds true for Theos, since it functions as a proper name in the New Testament. It usually has the article ha Theos, and you will drop the article in translation if appropriate. Greek often includes the article with abstract nouns. That's what I was trying to remember, abstract nouns. When we had, for as my man came, death. Death is an abstract noun. The truth, hey, aletheia.
Like, I am the way, the truth, and the life.
Yeah. Well, there you do. Translate the article.
Right, but that's ordinarily what.
Yeah.
That's a kind of a weird one.
Yeah.
That's very memorable.
English does not normally use the article with abstract nouns, but in John 14:6, it does. That's an exception to that rule. So that's why he says doesn't normally. And you may omit it in translation. I think the reason the article is translated in English in that verse is to emphasize the point that there's only one.
Yeah, it's to re-emphasize the second part of the verse. No one comes to the Father.
Exactly. Yes, exactly.
And I would imagine the noun way, right? Someone could say, I am truth, right? And that would be a sensical phrase, but I am way doesn't make any sense.
Okay.
Right. Got a good point.
So, the way you know, yeah. You need to
right.
In the book of First John, God is love. And there probably is an article in that verse, right. But you would not right. translate the article.
Right.
By the way, I've had a little fun with some of my classes in the past. I'd like it if we could memorize some verses in Greek. Not yet, but I had them memorize John 14:6. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes from the Father but by me. And the way I did it is I made a little tune to go along with it. And I'd like to teach that to you at some point.
We're eager.
You are. Okay. but I'll save that for later. Postpositive. A postpositive is a word that cannot be the first word in a Greek sentence or clause, even though it will usually be the first word in your translation. It usually is the second word and sometimes the third word in Greek order. There are only a few postpositives, but in this chapter you will learn the word de, meaning but or and. Yes. Oh, this is Jesse. Yes, I, de, and de, he underlines it because that's the postpositive word. Eganesen ton Dawid. And Jesse, so see, they put and as the first word of the translation, and Jesse became the father of David. There are a few other words like gar, means for, F-O-R, and it's a postpositive. A lot of the conjunctions are postpositives.
So not all postpositives are conjunctions.
That's right. But many of the postpositive words are conjunction. I have another book here called Complete Vocabulary Guide to Greek New Testament by Trenchard. And I think he's got a whole chart here of postpositive words. So I could give you a listing of all of those. But he's going to introduce them one at a time. An oddity of de is that when used with the article ha, generally means he. Ha de apen is translated, but he. Remember that. You might mark it in your book if you want to. That's going to come up in one of your exercises. And you, it'll be hard to find it if you don't mark it somehow.
Yes, I see that. So they will insert a conjunction between the article and the noun and the verb.
Well, yes, in this case, it's not necessarily.
Not necessarily.
Well, but it's not necessary that the third word be a verb.
No,
It's right. Just that the postpositive word cannot be the first in the sentence or a clause.
Yeah.
By the way, a clause, the word clause, phrase, and sentence have distinct meanings. A sentence is a collection of words that at minimum has a noun and a verb. It can have more. A clause is a, you have, for instance, dependent clauses and independent clauses. And that also has a noun and a verb and maybe other words too, adjectives, even direct objects, things like that. But it's not a standalone thing. A dependent clause isn't, I should say. It depends on the rest of the sentence to complete the meaning. A phrase is a smaller group of words. For instance, a prepositional phrase will have a preposition and a noun, which is the object of the preposition. It may also have articles, adjectives, and other things, but it cannot stand alone. It's not a complete sentence. Mm-hmm. It doesn't have a verb. Okay. By the way, what's that? Right, it does not. I gave as a handout a while back.
I guess we'll be getting to the point we can recognize.
Getting in there, the sentence was defined differently. What we're describing is the parts of a sentence, but you define sentence as a complete thought.
Yeah, it's a complete thought. It can stand alone, like the verse, Jesus wept. Jesus is the subject, wept is the verb. That's a complete sentence. I handed out this English grammar. I worked this up for, it's got a little more information, but I think it talks about clauses and phrases and things like that. Did everybody get one?
I don't know if I did.
So right now, the Greek, looking at the Greek, we can't, I can't see the phrases, but we'll begin to recognize these things.
Yeah, I think so.
Because obviously they're.
I don't know if you got the
orders. They're different.
This is a copy from the first. Well, the King's will make you think about
English grammar, Carl.
The King's is
your handout about the English grammar.
Yeah.
Is that what you mentioned?
And I can say that from experience, even on your study.
Yeah.
Because Yeah. Russian has a pretty similar case system to Greek as far as how it functions. And yeah. The case system, once you figure it out in Russian, just made figuring
sure.
out the sentence easy.
Yeah.
Okay, one more thing and then we'll adjourn. The fog. Somebody please read that who hasn't read before.
You are now entering the fog. You will have read this chapter and think you understand it, and perhaps you do, but it will seem foggy. That's okay. If living in the fog becomes discouraging, look back two chapters and you should understand that chapter clearly. And two more chapters, this chapter will be clear, assuming you keep studying.
Yeah, we just touch it.
Goes back to being out of context. In two chapters, we'll have the context to understand this.
Yeah. But that's we used to reading. Joke in our classes about the fog has shifted.
When I was in seventh grade, I read the entire La Morte d'Arthur. I understood almost none of it. My reading scores burst through the seams because it forced me to deal with language that I wanted to learn desperately, because you know that seventh grade, that was a big thing for me. But it helped my, so I'm kind of feeling that same sense with this, that even though so much is over my head, because I don't have, you know, a linguistic background, it's hopeful. It's like swimming toward light when you're mm-hmm. underwater.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah. It's not the sense of drowning. It's a sense of maybe I won't drown, but it's a good one. I mean, you're looking up
yeah.
instead, or at least for me, this way.
It is hopeful.
That's the way I'm yeah. emotionally dealing with it.
Well. The learning is going to be in doing the exercises. I think Dave can attest to that right now. You worked hard at that.
I went back and looked at the chapter and made flashcards for the things I thought I had to memorize. I mean, mm-hmm. the things he said were important, and made my flashcards. And then I just studied the flashcards. And then when I'm looking at the translation, if I can't remember something, I reference my flashcards. Because it's too hard to find in the book.
Okay. We're essentially done with the chapter. What we haven't done is the vocabulary. He's got a summary, which is kind of a review. And I'm going to assign for you to learn the vocabulary on your own. Make flashcards if it helps you. And I recommend doing that. But we won't have a quiz for this vocabulary section yet. I'm going to, from time to time, have a vocabulary quiz the way we did it before, just verbally. And we won't have it for chapter 6. But I want you to start translating into exercises. And I meant to bring my answer sheets for this chapter. I forgot it at home, but I'll bring it next week. And did I understand you correctly? Just a minute, Dave. I mean,
yeah.
All
right.
I'm a walk.
Oh, no. Yeah, you can't bend over.
You guys can all pray for my poor wife. Thank you. Thank you, Carl, very much.
So please get started on the exercises. If you don't finish them by next week, that's okay. I'd like to discuss some of it with you. We'll do some together if we need to. But as I told Dave before the class started, what I'd like to have as a pattern is we won't start doing the exercises in the workbook until we finish reading the chapter. But once we do, then whether I say so or not, start working on the exercises.
Well, that's good. Okay.
All right. I had also meant to bring a copy of a study I did on the word agape and phileo. because we talked about that last week. It's a very lengthy study. It was 13 printed pages. Is there a way, Dave, that that can be put on?
Sure.
Okay.
If you give me the printed copy, I'll scan it and put it up on the,
okay, on the page. Can that also be done with my answers to the?
Sure. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Anything that's printed, I could scan.
Yeah. I'll bring it to you. Maybe Sunday.
Sure.
I'll see you Sunday. Yeah. Right? Okay. I'll bring it Sunday. You can put it on there for anybody to use. And I might have said it already. I'd like to suggest you don't look at the answers I've got until after you've tried your level best to do them yourself. That's the way you learn. But the answers are there, and you might even find a mistake or two in my answers. I'll give you a prize if you do.
We'll be on the lookout.
Okay. Somebody close us in prayer, please.
I'll pray. Father, thank you for this time to learn, and even as much of the study is academic, we see the fruits of the learning already, and thank you for Carl and the work that he's done. Thank you for these men and the work that we're all doing together. I pray that you continue to bless us throughout the completion of this study and be with us in our work and in our families. Help us to find ways to glorify you and all that we do in Christ's name.
Thank you. Ray, do you have to miss next week, or when is your next time?